Matter of fact, it's categorized as the longest book of the Bible.
Amen.
It's a book that, and we talked about this before, about Psalms. We know it's a collaboration of songs, poems, and praises that were written unto the Most High. The Most High being God. David is accredited with this psalm, and in this psalm, being the longest psalm, it's a little different than the rest of them. Y'all, if you look in your Bible, you have a King James Bible, you'll see some letters or some words that come before every portion of this psalm. Those are the Hebrew alphabets, the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Each one, each stanza is broken down by this Hebrew letter, and they are in alphabetical order. If you don't know Hebrew, it's not going to help you, but trust me when I tell you that each section under that letter, the first word of each line starts with that letter. It's what you call an acrostic poem. Y'all may know these. I remember Valentine's Day, you would write a poem and you would write the word love straight up and down on your paper, and love. You would start the first line with something, love the way you look in the morning, and always, Omar is so handsome, that's an acrostic poem. Y'all know what I'm talking about? So here David wrote this acrostic poem about God, but what stood out to me was 38 times in this poem, he said, thy word. 38 times he mentions thy word. It's the most that it's ever been mentioned in the Bible. Thy word being mentioned 38 different times. You can go all the way back to somewhere around, what's that, the 9th verse. It says, wherein thou shall a young man be cleansed in all of his ways by taking heed thereto according to thy word. And then it goes on and says, with my whole heart have I sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Y'all know this one too, verse number 11. It says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Thy word. So why is it that the biggest book in the Bible decides to mention thy word so many times, and yet I've never preached on it? So I decided today that's what we'll do. We will just talk about thy word. Sometimes we want to get too dramatic. We want to get too deep. We want to look at the figurative and the literal meanings of everything, and we forget the little words that matter, the stuff in here, that word. That's what matters today. It's just that word. If y'all come here to hear what Omar has to say, I'm sorry. You're in the wrong place. I come here to preach thy word. My book in Romans tells me that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing comes from the word of God. But how then shall they hear unless a preacher be sent? And how shall they preach? Y'all know that. We're going to talk about thy word. Thy word is in this text. David is writing this acrostic poem as a praise unto God, and thy word that he is talking about is what we would classify as the law. The law being the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, y'all know Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, and Numbers. I'm sorry if I botched the order a little bit, but trust me, those five books make up the Pentateuch, the five books written by Moses. That's what the Jewish folks lived by. That was their creed. That was their way of life. The problem was they could not live up to it. The law was setting them up to fail. See, the law, we couldn't survive under the law, but that's why we had a Christ that came. That's why Jesus Christ came. We are out of the dispensation that the law is applied, and we're in a new era called the dispensation of grace. See, grace comes, and grace will cover a multitude of sins. That word, though. Let's just talk about that word.
Amen.
The problem with the church is, there's a lot of problems. The problem that I will talk about today with the church is we decide when we want to take the Bible literally versus figuratively. We try to make that decision, and the truth is that is not our decision to make. The truth is that we ought to be taking the the Bible very literal and also still looking for the figurative meaning. What do you mean? When you read anything, it has a literal meaning. I can't go jump off a bridge. Do I literally mean jump off a bridge? But if the Bible says it, I'm jumping.
That's right.
We've got to learn to read our Bibles literally. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Literally, that would mean that this book here would illuminate my steps. That's the literal translation. And some would say, but there's no illumination coming out of the book. And I would say, you are a liar. Because if you simply open up the book and you begin to read what is in the book, it will instruct you on your next move in life. But the problem is we confused and stressed out because we've never opened up our books. We wait until Sunday when the preacher gets up to preach to blow off the dust off our Bible, if we even decide to bring it in the church and open it up and read along with it. But trust me, one verse is not going to carry you through all the hell the devil is trying to attack you this week. One verse is not going to help you overcome if that's all you got. The David said, thy word have I hid in my heart. Meaning I have absorbed this thing and I put it inside of me. How am I able to smile when the world is against me? Thy word have I hid in my heart. How am I able to get up and face everyday challenges? Because it's thy word that gives me power. Thy word is what keeps me straight. You've got to be able to open up your Bible and know that through Christ I can do all things. But how shall you know it unless somebody preaches? Somebody's got to open up the book and preach to you. Thy word, the literal translation. Thy word is the Holy Bible. That's literally what thy word is. As David was writing, it is the Pentateuch, it is the law, it is the way of God.
Yes.
Oh, but if we still look at it in a figurative way, or as my, y'all went back to school now, so English class, y'all, you guys know what a metaphor is, right?
Yes.
A metaphor will take one thing and use it to compare it to something else. David didn't know that metaphorically he was writing about another word. The word that was mentioned here in the Old Testament, we look at it now and say it's what we call a Christophany. In other words, Jesus Christ being mentioned in the Old Testament before he hit the scene. But I just read the 119th division or portion of Psalm, and I read all about thy word. And I read that thy word is a lamp. I read that thy word is a light. Somewhere around the 27th Psalm, I read that the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? So David didn't know exactly who he was talking about back then. Oh, but I'm so glad that even now I can look back and I can understand who David didn't even know he was writing about. He was writing about what we call a noun. It was a noun he was writing about. It was a person, a place, or a thing. But even though thy word here was not capitalized, because it was not a, what you call them things when you capitalize a noun, like your name, what is that? Proper noun. Thank you. Somebody did the English. So David wasn't writing about the proper noun. But he didn't think he was, at least. But when I opened up the New Testament and I turned to the book of John, if somebody wants to flip to John chapter 1. John chapter 1 said, in the beginning was the Word. Capital W. And the capital Word was with God. And the capital Word was God. And the same was in the beginning with God. And all things were made by Him. And without Him, nothing was made. The life was the light unto all men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness couldn't even understand. Matter of fact, the darkness couldn't even put it out. That was the word he was talking about. But if y'all kept reading, you know that this word he's talking about is the one that we preach Sunday after Sunday. The one that went on the old rugged cross and died for. Some of us want to take the word and make it what we want it to be. What do you mean? What do you mean? We want to use the word to convict people. We want to use the word to condemn people. Or we want to use the word and tell people how wrong they're living. But if I may for a moment just step back to David and it said, thy word is a lamp unto my feet. I don't have time to condemn anybody else. I don't have time to talk bad about anybody else. Because this word is a lamp to my feet. I don't have time to worry about you. If you want to sin, you go ahead. This word is for my feet.
Start reading the word, ain't that what the devil want to attack you? The devil want to come and mess with you, want to see, because
because you're weak, you're vulnerable. Oh, but when you're filled up with the word, and there's no more room for any other junk to get inside you. Oh, I'll be honest. Can I be transparent? The weeks that I'm in my word and I'm in my word heavy, y'all, I don't get that upset. Matter of fact, my temper is pretty good those weeks. I can smile at people. I'm more cheerful. I give more. I sin less. Oh, but watch this. But let me forget to read my word. It starts off the first day you just forgot. The second day, it turns out you conveniently forgot. By the third day, you just don't even feel like reading. The fourth day, you found something else that filled in your word time. And by the fifth day, come on, y'all, come on. By the fifth day, you done found something else that's going to fill in that time that you would have been spending with God. And because you're not spending time with God, I got news for you. You're sinning now. Whether you're doing something what you feel is right or wrong, if you're omitting to spend time with God, you got sins of omission. That's things you forget to do or leave out. And then you got sins of commission. Those are the things that you do that you know you shouldn't do, yet you still do them. Y'all follow me? But when you fill yourself up with the word, I'm not saying you're not going to sin, because that's not word-based. The word tells us, for all will still sin and fall short of his glory, but yet that is why he came and died. Yeah. We want to make it seem like Jesus Christ only came and died for the ones that decide to come to church and wear a suit and tie. Jesus did not only die for the deacons and the deaconess. He did not just die for the trustees or the reverends. He did not just die for you that comes to church and pay your tithe. But trust me, Jesus died for the world. He died for the alcoholics. He died for the drug addicts. He died for the prostitutes. He died for the lesbians and the homosexuals. He died. Oh, all right, go ahead. That's what my word tells me. And as long as I'm feeding myself with the word, I don't have to worry about walking in darkness. Because my Bible tells me that darkness can't comprehend what I got on the inside of me. Darkness can't even understand what fills me up. Darkness can't understand what keeps me going. And every time the prince of darkness tries to attack me, I've got to go deeper in my word. And I look at that devil and I tell him that yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Understand, in order for there to be a shadow, there's got to be a source of light. And I know that light, the 27th Psalm, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. I don't care if you believe in God. promises you.
Yeah.
Oh, you wouldn't walk out here the same way. If you knew that this word promises you life and more abundant life, you can't walk out here upset. But you got to read your word. You got to become one with the word.
Hallelujah.
This is your flashlight. When times get dark and times are hard, oh, when you see the bills but you don't see the money, come on now. The word. When you open up your fridge and it's empty, word. But yet somehow you ate. Some of y'all got problems. I think the problem is, I don't know what to cook tonight. A real problem is, I don't know where my food is coming from for tonight. Oh, but I don't care which side you're on. But you got the word on the inside. Oh, but either one of those things are a problem. We serve a God that will take care of you. You take care of the sparrow. I know he'll watch over me. I'm gonna tell y'all, man, over this past 2.5 years, I've watched every doctor and nurses telling my son should be dead. I spent nights, and I'm not afraid to tell you, when I gotta get up in the middle of the night and put my hand on my son's chest to make sure he's breathing, because I'm paranoid. The only thing that kept me going is the word. Yeah. Why sometimes I come here, I don't let everybody know me. I sweep the back corner, but I gotta get my shot on. I gotta hear the word. And you never know what that person sitting next to you is going through. Next to somebody with a smile on their face, and you don't know what they're going through. You don't know what kind of pain they're doing. And when they start praising God, you look at them funny. But let me tell you something: when the word is on the inside of you, Jeremiah said, sometimes it's just like a fire. Bibles this week and go ahead and start in Genesis and start reading the word. I dare you. I dare you. I dare you just open up your Bible and start reading. Watch how God will bless your life. You start seeing God in places that you've never seen Him before. I started recognizing God in people at my job that I thought didn't know nothing about God. But I would see characteristics of God in them. But the reason why I was missing it, because I didn't really know who God was, because I was not reading it for myself. Somebody in here does not know this God that I'm talking about. Well, now's your chance. There's an old song. Give me some invitation music. Let's get right with God. Word.